Today we're preaching on the 10 core values. I'm taking a little break away from our teaching through the Sermon on the Mount so that we can review the 10 core values. Now, as you're receiving these, there is a one side of it. Don't worry, I'm not preaching both sides of it. Actually, I am. I am preaching both sides of it, but it's the same thing. So before you discover that and go, hey, look, all the answers are on the back already. Well, the answers are right there too, so don't get too excited. One side has fill-in-the-blank, so if you're just like a fill-in-the-blank kind of hound, and you're just like, yeah, I love fill-in-the-blanks, and you fill in those blanks as we go. And for the rest, it became important to me that we go through these 10 core values of our church every year. Last year, I went through them once, one sermon for each of those 10, so it took 10 weeks to get through the 10 core values. This year, I'm just going to do all 10 of them in one service. Next year, I might do all 10 again. However, I want you to learn and grow these, and I want you to become familiar with them, and I want them to become part of your DNA, because we need them. Every one of these things are things that we need, and so I'm going to go over each of these in just a moment. Go ahead and go to the next slide for me, though, April, if you would. Before we go any farther, I did mention that you have one side that has the fill-in-the-blanks. The other side is already filled in for you. Now, here's what I want you to do with your paper. Do not leave it on the chair, all right? Please take it with you, because I want you to post these at your house. If you got a bulletin board, put it on your bulletin board. If you got a refrigerator with a magnet, put it on your refrigerator. If you tape stuff to your mirror at home in the bathroom, then tape it to your mirror at the bathroom. But keep these things with you. Go over them again and again because they are necessary and useful. So please take the notes you have and tuck it in your Bible at least, but at even better that you post them somewhere and continue to review them as you go. Why? Is this the most important sermon I'm doing all year? Of course it is. Of course it is. Why? Because it's the one that the Lord gave for us today. But I do believe the principles in here come back again and again and again and again, and we need them. And we'll go through those. So Jesus gave us the 10 core values. You may not have recognized those specifically in Scripture anywhere, but let me show you where they came from. First of all, we got the great commandment. Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul, and with all your mind." This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. And then the great commission he gave us says, "And he said unto them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature." And between the great commandment and the great commission are all the things that we need to know, basically, and that is that we should love God. We need to love others. That's what we find in the Great Commandment. Love God and love others. And in the Great Commission, we find that we should save the planet. Does that make sense? Save the planet? Rocket Town, you know, it's the whole theme. Yeah, save the planet. So love God, love others, and save the planet. Now you see why it's laid out that way in your outline. Go ahead and go to the next one for me, please, April. So our core values come from the Great Commandment and the Great Commission. So love God, you saw it in red, and love others, both of those on there, and then save the planet at the bottom. Now, tucked in around the love God, love others, and save the planet, you'll see all the 10 core values in their respective areas on there. So go to the next slide for us. So we're going to start with love God. Love God. Anybody think it's a good idea to love God? Does anybody love God? Okay. That's good. About a third of the church loves God, all right? Let's be honest. We don't always love God, do we? I don't. I should. And I do. But when I got saved, I didn't love God. I got saved as an elevator out of hell. Let's be honest. I didn't want to go to hell. That's what I was interested in. That's what got my attention. And I got saved because I did not want to go to hell. I think that's a pretty good reason for getting saved. It was for me. But as I've grown in my faith, and I've seen the faithfulness of God, and I've had relationship with Him over time, I have begun to fall in love with Him. You see, you know, John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son." And I'm one of those persons He gave His Son for. He loved me first. Herein is love, not that we love Him, but that He loved us and gave His life for us. So He loved me first. And yet the commandment of Scripture in the Old Testament, and Jesus repeats as being the greatest of the commandments, is that we should love God. And then he goes on to explain how much we should love God. This is something we have to work at. Do I love my wife? You better believe it, she says. Why do I love my wife? Because I put time into that relationship. I put time and effort into growing with her and spending time with her and so forth. And love God starts with, we put the first three things under love God. First of all, is worship passionately. If you love something, you're going to worship it. If you love money, you're going to worship it. You're going to be working all day long. You're going to be doing deals. You're going to stay in late at work. You're going to be loving that money. You're going to be playing the stock market. You're going to be looking at your account daily. You're going to be loving that a great deal. If you're going to worship the nature and the boat, you're going to be out on there instead of here on Sunday morning, so you won't hear me complaining about it. If you love golf more than God, you're going to be out there doing that instead of being here. Whatever you love is what you're going to worship. And so since Jesus said that we should love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, then he says then we need to learn to worship passionately. And that's our first core value, is worship passionately. That means, what does that mean? It means you don't just show up to church and just say, okay, I'm here, give me a brownie button just because I made it. Gold star, good job, you made it. Everybody do it like this. Reach around like this and pat yourself on the back. Oh, somebody's listening in church. Another gold star. All right. There's my reward. And there's your reward. The praise of men. Give it to him, folks. Give it to him. There you go. How'd you like that? Yeah, right. Yeah, yeah. Never mess with the man with the microphone. You know that. But we should worship passionately. Worship passionately. What does that look like for you? Now, you may be a personality type that is just hot-blooded, and you start moving and grooving with a groove. You get excited. When you get mad and angry, you get loud. And whenever you get sad about something, you just cry. You know, maybe you're really close to your passions, and you're going to worship in a style that's going to reflect that. Now, maybe on the other hand, you're some pretty conservative person, and no, you don't cry. And you certainly don't laugh out loud. And that's just not who you are. And whenever you worship, you're probably, you know, you'd be doing good. If April says, all right, everybody raise your hand, you're like, you know, okay, is this good enough? You know, it's like I didn't wear deodorant today, so I'm not going all the way up there. And that's okay. But it doesn't matter what personality type you are. You be who God made you to be. That's okay. But I know. Then I came from a background that nobody worshiped like this. Nobody raised their hands and praised God. Nobody cried during worship, unless you're tired of it going so long or something. There was none of that, you know. But I started getting into a situation and into a church that taught me how to worship God. That we weren't just there to do the song service. If we weren't just there to sing the hymns, this is what we do. I don't even know why we did it. We just come, you know, we sing three hymns, sit down, and then the offering, and then the message. It was just the way it was done. I never thought about it. But then I started going to a church that taught me that worship was an important part of my life, and that worship was often very well expressed, not only in giving and showing up, but in actually singing and praising God. That praise and worship kind of went together in singing. That I could actually show up and I could sing praises to God, not just about Him. You see, that's what I didn't get in often many of the hymns that I sang. And there's nothing wrong with the hymns. They're glorious. Many of them are awesome. But what I didn't get in hymn book singing was the opportunity to worship Him. I would sing about Him, but I didn't sing to Him. I would worship or express worship about Him, but I did not express worship to Him. And as I began to comprehend that as I be singing songs, and I began to realize that not looking down like this all the time at the song sheet or the hymn book, you know, they started singing off the wall like we do. And it's like, wow, sometimes I just close my eyes and tune out the world. And I began to realize I'm actually singing these words to God. They were to God kind of words. You know, Lord, I come in with a heart of worship, and it's all about You. It's all about You, Jesus. And as I'm singing those kinds of words, I'm beginning to realize I've got something to say to Him. I've got something to say to God. Well, He's already heard that song. You don't need to hear me sing it again. Yes, He does. Yes, he does. It was like April was saying. We worship and praise like a little kid running up and jumping up in daddy's lap saying, look what I made for you. I realize that my voice is not used in singing as much as it used to. And so I'm singing away here this morning, and maybe it's the time of year and all that, and all of a sudden I'm like hearing squeak and off the woo. Good thing I'm not mic'd up for singing. And I'm trying to keep it down because I'm singing toward them and I don't want to get them off key, and you know, I'm afraid the mics might pick it up, and I'm thinking, ooh, that's a mess. And then April said that thing, which she did, about hopping up in Papa's lap and saying, look what I made for you, Daddy. So I just kind of snickered to God and say, look what I sang for you, Daddy. You know, did you like it? And I just think, God, going, yes, of course, I loved it. It was great. You know, no, it wasn't. It stank. It was childish. It was poor. But not in the Father's eyes. Not in the Father's eyes. In the Father's eyes, He loves the expression of praise and worship we give Him, sometimes in small, piddly amounts. But He says to His Jesus encouragement, you shall love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. You know, I am a big science nut, if you haven't already known about it. I love astronomy. I love science fiction, too, but I love astronomy. I love real science and real astronomical things. I love knowing how things work. I'm one of these, you know, I geek out on my little astronomy blogs I read every week and watch videos and all like that. And it was interesting to me that one person that I heard talk, he was an atheist, non-Christian completely. They're always surprised whenever Christians read their blogs. I've seen them argue with each other about whether or not, well, that kind of sounds like what creationists would say God was all about it. Well, no, and the other witness says back, well, don't you worry about it. I don't think any creationists watch this blog anyway. And I had just typed in, you know, thank you for sharing that. It just shows me the glory of God. And then he goes, I'm writing this as I see your blog. Sorry about that. Glad to see you're welcome aboard. You know, often atheists are surprised that people of faith could also be people of science. But as I was watching one of those kinds of blogs, someone said, who was not a Christian, he said, I believe that the God of the Bible is too small of a God for the universe. That the universe is so great and so vast that the God of the Bible just is too small. So therefore, I don't believe in him. Well, clearly he hasn't read the first verse. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. You know? So we need to decide what we believe about God now. Do we believe that God created the heavens and the earth? Then he's a big enough God to do it. And if we believe that from the very beginning of the book, then he's a God who's worthy of all the praise and glory that we can give him. He's worthy of all this. We need to think about, what do you believe about God right now? Where is God in your mindset? Where is God in your life? If you believe that God is worth worshiping, then we need to worship him. If you believe that God is a creator, he created heaven and earth, then we need to worship him. If you haven't got all your science and theology worked out, please come. I love talking about these things. But in the meantime, believe him and worship him. He's worthy. Worship the Lord with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength. This is the first commandment. He's not too small. Then we should pray effectively is the second one on here. Pray effectively. Go to the verse, April. The scripture is James 5:16. It says, confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another. No, by the way, don't just pray about one another. Pray for one another that you may be healed. Now, James is talking to the church as he says this. He's not just talking to individuals. He's saying, hey, y'all. Okay, I don't know if he's Southern or not, but if he was, he'd do the plural. Hey, y'all. Confess y'all's trespasses to one another. Aren't you supposed to confess your sins to God? Well, yeah. Well, then why are we confessing to one another? That you may be healed. That you may be healed. You see, whenever you think you got it all together, when you act like you got it all together, when someone walks up, hey, how you doing? I'm good. I'm good. I know you're not good. Many of you let me know that you're not good in private. And yet, you know, some of you, hey, how you doing? I'm good. We need to There is a time and a place to say, I'm good. Good, thanks, how are you? But then there's a time where we begin to realize that as we open up and confess our faults one to another, then we trust one another more. You see, if you're perfect, I'm not going to fit in your world too well. And if I'm perfect, you're not going to fit in my world too well. But if I'm broken and in need of a Savior, and you're broken and in need of a Savior, man, we can connect. We can connect around the one who makes us holy. So we need to confess our faults one to another, admit that we're not perfect to one another, that we may be healed. Because nobody can pray for you to be fixed in whatever your brokenness is unless they know how you are. And then it says, the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. First of all, you got to pray. And then you got to pray with a fervency. A fervency means like with a lot of passion, like you really care about it. Now, remember a while ago I talked about worshiping and different personality types and how you may, you know, worship more expressively or more conservatively than someone next to you. That's okay. I get that. But when it comes to prayer, there's no personalities here. Everybody prays. Everybody may worship in their own style, but when it comes to prayer, he says that we should all pray fervently. Fervently. That doesn't mean foaming at the mouth. But it does mean like you really mean it, like you really care about the answer. If you're going to come to God about something that you care about enough to take the time to talk to Him, first of all, He wants to hear it. And secondly, if you're going to take the time to talk to Him about it, pray about it with a passion that you believe that He hears you and that He is a rewarder of you because you diligently seek Him. Pray like He hears you. Pray like you want Him to hear you. Pray in a way that you would be like, hey, whoa, over here. Now, God's hand is not short that He cannot save. His ear is not dull that He cannot hear you. But we need to pray in such a way that it's like, ooh, hey, God, over here. Hey, can you deal with this? This is a real problem for me. I'm having a lot of problems. God, can you please take this on? Lord, I'm serious about this. I really want you to handle this. You might need to fast. You might need to fast and show your fervency with God in prayer. Not to prove anything to Him, but to keep you on task and fervent in prayer. You might need to pray with a fervency that you haven't prayed before. And then pray with expectation. Pray with faith. It says here, it says, confess your trespasses one to another. Pray for one another that you may be healed. So that something that you expect to happen will happen. We don't just pray because we're Christians. We pray because we want an answer. We pray because we want an answer. Has anybody had answered prayer lately? I mean, I hope so, and I'm glad for the hands, and it's a rhetorical question, really. You don't have to raise your hand, but think about it. Have you been praying and seeing answers to prayer? If you have not been seeing answers to prayer, you have two choices. One is to give up praying because it doesn't work. Or two, say, I need to be more fervent in prayer. I need to have more faith in prayer. I need to start praying according to His Word. I need to read my Bible more so I know what His will is. I need to pray according to His will. We need to do something a little more fervent than we've done before. Pray with an expectation that God is going to hear and answer prayer. And then let that build your faith. Share those answered prayers with others and let them be encouraged as well. All right, so worship passionately, pray effectively, and then grow gradually. Another core value. Now, there's two parts of growing gradually. First of all, personal, and then as corporately as a church. Let's talk about the personal aspects first. In Luke chapter 2 and verse 52, it says, and Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men. That basically means that Jesus, the young man, grew up. He came to earth as a baby. He grew into adolescence, and then he grew up from there. This particular passage is talking from the time frame where he was probably 12 years old, visiting the temple and showing his wisdom, talking with the scribes and so forth. They're impressed with him. But it says, Jesus increased in wisdom. If Jesus increased in wisdom, do you think maybe we ought to increase in wisdom? I need to increase in wisdom. If Jesus increased in wisdom, I need to increase in wisdom. It also says he increased in favor with God. Do you think you ought to increase in favor with God? Yeah, I think so. Now, could God love you any more than He already does? God loves you so much. God loves you. the way you are. But whenever you show an expression of love back, you can increase in favor. Whenever you walk in obedience, you can increase favor. God loves you just like you love your own children, probably better. But if one child is obedient and the other one is a hellraiser, you're going to love both of them. You're going to sacrifice for both of them. You're going to provide for both of them. But one of them is going to gain some favor because of obedience. And so we also need to increase in our obedience and favor with God. Jesus always did the right thing, so he was always ever increasing in favor with God. Increase in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men. And he didn't grow up all of a sudden. It took him a whole 33 years or whatever to grow into adulthood, or 30 years in those days to grow into adulthood, just like it takes your whole life to grow up now. Jesus wasn't in a hurry. And so if you're in a hurry to get super spiritual, I'm happy for you. I want you to be that way. But if you're getting a little frustrated and feel like, man, I screw up so much. You know, I try and it's New Year, so I'm going to read my Bible through in a year. And you get about Leviticus or something and you're like, that's it, you know. Don't worry. You keep at it. It takes a while to grow up. It takes a while. You keep at it. Keep growing. Keep moving forward. And so the other part of growing and in gradual growth is in Ephesians 2:21. I put verses 20 to 22 on the board. So let's read it off of there. It says, having been built on the foundation of the... Talking about the church. Talking about you and I. Having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. So he's the foundation. He's the cornerstone on which everything else is built. In him, in whom, Jesus, the whole building, which is the church, being fitted together... We don't always fit together well, do we? Being fit together grows. Everybody say grows. Grows into a holy temple in the Lord. There are people in this church who are not very spiritual, and they think this is just a great place to come. There are people in this church who are very spiritual, way too spiritual for the pastor, way too spiritual for the church, and have decided that maybe they need to look around and go somewhere else. I don't know. I think Pastor Pete said it the best. People get on the bus and people get off the bus. It isn't just a bus. People get on and off. I hope most of you stay for the longest time. But we don't always fit together well, but he's getting us to grow into a holy temple in the Lord. We are not all we should be as a church. We are not all we should be as individuals. But it's okay. We're growing. We're growing as a church and growing closer to Christ, growing in number, growing in favor with God and man, growing as we go. We should be continually, gradually, more and more every day growing in the Lord into a holy temple in whom you also are being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. The Spirit of God wants to dwell in this place as a church. If this is not a spiritual place to be, then why are you here? Go find a church that's spiritual. But we are growing together and to be a place, a temple that is growing in God. Temple, by definition, is a place where the Spirit of God dwells. Now, there's a lot of pagan temples where they want demons to dwell, and there's all kinds of temples out there. But the true temple, the temple of Israel of the Old Testament, the temple that is in the heavenlies now, is the place where God dwells. And he said, your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. And do you not know that the Spirit of God dwells in you because your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? And then by extension, therefore, we as a body, a church, grow together, and we together corporately are also the body of Christ. And so as we together are corporately the body of Christ, each one of us stones in that building, each one of us contributing to the whole, then we create a place where God dwells, His Spirit dwells. We create an atmosphere together on Sunday morning when we worship, when we pray, when we give. We create an atmosphere for the Spirit of God to dwell. Maybe there's going to be a special word from God through the pastor. Maybe it's going to be a special word of God through somebody who the Lord just gives you a special word. Maybe the Lord's going to do something special through you and you're going to worship in a way you've never worshiped before. Maybe we're all going to worship together with fervency and passion and we're going to see God just come in and just, we can't even define it. It's just like God showed up today. You know? Or maybe we're going to pray for one another with a fervency, and the Spirit of God in our prayers answers prayers immediately. We see people healed. We see people's lives turn around. We see attitudes change like that. Why? Because the Spirit of God is in the house, in the place. And not only does the Holy Spirit of God live in you individually, but we together become the body of Christ. And as the temple of God in this way, we're growing up in Him. And every day we need to grow more numerically. We need more stones. We need to bring more people in. And each one of us then together need to continue to walk in the Spirit and create an atmosphere of worship and praise, and with an expectation that God's going to do something when you come here. I hope you come to church with an expectation God's going to do something. If He's either going to do something to me, or He's going to do it for somebody else, He's going to do something for the church, but I'm coming looking for what God's going to do. A heart of expectation, a heart of faith that says, I want God to do something here today. I'm going to worship my best. I'm going to give my best. I'm going to give my attention my best. I'm going to do everything I can to create an environment where God is going to show up in His Spirit and do what He wants to do here. That's the way I want to be. It's where I want to be as a church. So we should grow gradually. And then we should live fearlessly. Come on, get an amen on that one. We need to live fearlessly. And if you don't live fearlessly, then I want you to consider coming into this class that April's going to teach and learn how to live fearlessly. Now, you may think, I'm not afraid of nothing. Are you afraid? Are you afraid of me? I'm afraid I wouldn't want to go there, brother. Somebody's going to get hurt. I ain't saying who. Okay. But we need to live fearlessly. But you know what? For as tough as the toughest guys are among us, the toughest of the tough, everybody lives in fear of one type or another. Everybody battles fear of one type or another. Maybe you are yea, though you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you shall fear no evil because you're the baddest dude in the valley. Maybe you are really that bad a dude. But yet you still carry fear. Fear that maybe you're not bad enough. Everybody, maybe you're afraid that you're not good enough. Maybe you're afraid that people won't accept you if you showed who you really are. Maybe you're afraid of failure. Maybe you are driven constantly and pushed in your job because you're afraid of failure. I don't know what you're afraid of. Maybe you're afraid of being a disappointment to somebody because you were a disappointment to your parents, or you feel like you were. I don't know what you're afraid of, but everybody's afraid of something. And the Bible says that we should live in a manner that is fearless. Well, you say, well, Pastor Steve, if everybody's afraid of something, then how are we going to obey that? Because there's something called walking in the Spirit. When you're walking in the Spirit instead of the flesh, then you overcome the weakness of the flesh and the weakness of fear. The Bible says in 2 Timothy 1:7, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Now, there's a major division in there that I see. First of all, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but instead of power, love, and a sound mind. Power implies the ability to make action happen. Love is something in action. Love is gifts and doing in action. And a sound mind means you are not going to be shaken by what you hear, but you have a plan to move forward in advance. You see, fear is reaction-based. If someone interacts with you in a way that really pushes your buttons, then your fear response will cause any one of a number of ugly responses. Most of the time, people pull your chain, push your buttons, and have no idea how they set you off. Now, if you're married to each other, you know exactly. But we all have these little things that we react to all the time. I'm afraid of, my fear trigger is incompetence. So I overcompensate in order to not be incompetent. I'm just telling you that. So what would my fear be? My fear then would be that I would be a failure of some type. So with fear of failure and my trying always to overcompensate to not be failure, than my wife telling me, did you turn the stove off? Did you leave a tip? You know, these things would drive me crazy. Do you have your wallet and keys before you walk out the door? Yes! I don't need to be told everything. I got this. I can do that. And yet we all relate in some kind of fear, but we react negatively when someone pushes our buttons. This is why you need to be in that class to learn what makes you go off. You react, your trigger. But no matter what makes you go off, no matter what your fear is, there is a way to overcome fear, and that is by being filled with the Spirit. He did not give you a spirit of fear, so therefore, when you are walking in the Spirit, you have the Holy Spirit of God working in you, and that is a spirit of power. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, meekness, self-control. All of those things that are missing whenever you are just going off with somebody. When you're reacting with your fear response to what someone says to you. When you're just like exploding back and you don't even know why you went off. Somebody pushed your buttons and you're not even sure, how did I get here? How did we get so angry so fast? You see, when you're walking in the Spirit, no matter what the fear cause, walking in the Spirit allows you to overcome that. He did not give you a spirit again to fear, but of power. Power to overcome things. Power to act on things instead of react all the time. The spirit of power and love in a sound mind. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering. Long-suffering. Long. Long-suffering my wife has to put up with me. Live fearlessly. All right. Number five, we need to connect sincerely. Now, don't go to sleep on me now. Oh, yes, thank you. The second subcategory here, loving God. We've talked about those things. Now we're going to talk about loving others. Another loving others, we need to connect with others sincerely. 1 John 3:18 says, my little children, let us not love in word or in tongue, but in deed and in truth. So, basically, disconnecting doesn't solve anything. If we need to connect sincerely, and he says, do not love in deed or truth, but do not love in word or in tongue, but in deed and truth. We need to connect sincerely. Disconnecting doesn't solve anything. When you have interpersonal issues with someone at church, the easy thing is to say, you know what, I'm just not going there anymore. I quit. I'm not doing that anymore. I'm not going to go there anymore. Whenever you have these kind of issues with family, the easy thing is just delete that. Delete them off Facebook. I'm done with you. I'm not talking to you anymore. You see, these are the things that do not work well. But when we connect with sincerity, when we connect sincerely, then we begin to care for and love one another in a way that makes us not willing to throw in the towel so easily. My little children. Why does he call us little children? Because we act like it. My little children, let us not love in word. Does that mean I can't tell you I love you? You can say it. But he says, don't only say the words, but rather, better, to show it. Now, here's love in word. Hey, man, how you doing? We need to get together. Let's have lunch sometime. Now, is that a bad thing? Yeah, at least it shows some good intention of connecting sincerely. We need to connect sincerely by saying, hey, how's Tuesday at noontime sound? See, that's put it on the calendar. You see, if you don't use a calendar, you might want to start. Because someday never comes. And so whenever you say, hey, let's get together sometime, that's good intention, and I've said it many times. I've probably said it to you, so don't judge. But if we don't put it on the calendar, then it never happens. If we don't make it the effort to connect, then we miss our connections all the time. Not only do we need to connect, we need to connect sincerely. We need to connect in deed and in truth. See, we need to connect in order to care. You don't care about the person across the church. You don't care about the person at the other end of the aisle if you don't connect with them. Now, it's not your fault that you don't care. You don't care because you don't connect. If you do connect with a person down the aisle or across the church, then you will care for them. And if you care for them, you will fight for relationship. You will fight for unity. You will fight for growth. But if you don't connect, then you won't care. So hear me, church. One of our core values must be that we connect and connect with sincerity. That we actually invite each other out to eat, to our house, to the bonfire. A lot of bonfire people in this church. That's a good thing. Yeah, it can be disturbing when you get men around a campfire. This is true. Things burn that maybe shouldn't be burned and things. But there needs to be an intentionalness about connecting. Because when we connect, then we care. But it's very easy to not care about another person if you don't know who they are. We need to connect sincerely. That means more than, hey, how you doing? Hey. See ya. Good to see ya. Wouldn't want to be ya. What it means is, I will ask your name again and again and again and again and again and again until I learn it, because you're important. That's sincerity. Sincerity of heart. We relate honestly because we care. All right, I mean, that's connecting sincerely. Number six is relating honestly. Ephesians 4:15 says, "But speaking the truth in love may grow up in all things into Him who is the head, even Christ." We need to relate honestly with one another. Now, this becomes important if you want to live fearlessly. Then you talk to each other about what bugs you. If you say, okay, I want to relate honestly. Let me just tell you what bugs me about you. let me just tell you. That can be a fearsome thing, and could be and should be for a reason. But not telling you how I feel about what you do does not make me connect sincerely. So connecting sincerely and relating honestly are very closely tied together. Yeah. Here, brother, have a breath mint. No, I'm good. No, please. You know. That's relating honestly. It's also telling the truth in love. It says, but speaking the truth in love may grow up in all things into Him who is the head, even Christ. People in this church, people in general, do not relate honestly with each other. They don't tell each other what bugs them. Now, nobody wants to hear everything you hate. You know what I hate? I heard this guy named Earl Pitts. I don't know if anybody... Earl Pitts, American. You know what I hate? You know what really burns me up? It's a little radio piece, you know. It's always funny, you know. But people don't care. In a way, they don't really care what bugs you. But they do care what bugs you if you have already connected sincerely with them. You see, if you've already connected sincerely, you have already established relationship with them, if you have shown them that you care for them, if you've gotten to know them and learn about them other than, hey, how you doing? And you get to know them a little bit and connect sincerely, then you can relate honestly with them. And if you'll relate honestly, do you know how much trouble goes on around people in church because they don't relate honestly with each other? You know who they relate honestly with? Or April. We will get calls on a regular basis about what somebody over here doesn't like about somebody over here. And what somebody over here did that this person over here hates or doesn't know about. And you know what our attempt to do is? Give you each other's number so you can talk to each other. Oh, I wouldn't want to do that. Well, why not? Well, I'd be embarrassed. Relate honestly, because if you relate honestly to each other, you have the opportunity to reconnect sincerely. Do you think people get offended around here? On a regular basis. By the way, the Bible says, do not be easily offended. Do not be easily offended. Jesus promised you will not be able to be in this world without being offended. He said it's impossible that offenses won't come. But Paul comes along and tempers it and say, be not easily offended. So, say this again. Be not easily offended. If you don't get anything else, if you don't get anything else out of this message, get this. Don't be easily offended. Now, if you want to be offended, but don't be easily offended. Relate honestly with each other. If you are afraid of relating honestly with someone else who has offended you, first, choose not to be offended. Then you won't have to go relate with them. Then you won't have to relate honestly. Then you won't even have to relate the truth in love. If you don't want to relate the truth in love, then just don't be offended. But if you are offended, and you can't help it, because somebody tried extra hard to offend you, which probably didn't really happen, but you perceived it to be something offensive because your fear response, then relate honestly with that person. Because when you do, most likely you will hear the rest of the story. You will hear that person saying, oh, did I say that? I'm sorry, I didn't mean that. I meant so-and-so. Or you took it that way? I'm sorry, I meant this. Most of the time, people aren't so nasty and mean and horrible that they offend you on purpose, knew they were doing it, and don't care. But in your mind, that's how they are. Am I lying? In your mind, it's like, I can't believe what they said to me. I can't believe that they didn't do so-and-so. I can't believe the way they looked at me. I can't believe... You know? Easily offended. Unwilling to relate honestly. Unable to connect sincerely. Man! Are you beginning to see why these things are important? It's what April and I scream at each other across the chairs in our easy chair. She's sitting in her chair, I'm sitting in mine. The phone hangs up or the text finishes and we go, OMG! Would you please just relate honestly with each other? Would you connect with each other? Oh my goodness. Huh? Yeah. Tell the truth in love, though. Tell the truth in love. Now, some of you might say, oh, this is easy for me. I'll tell you exactly how I feel. I got no problem telling you what you need to hear. For those of you that's you, tell the truth in love. In love. Everybody say, in love. Tell the truth in love. That means pray about how to say what you got to say. Not whether to say it. You see, part of relating honestly and connecting sincerely is that you have to speak up when there's a problem, when there's an offense. You have to speak up in order to fix it. Okay? So you don't pray about whether or not to say something. You pray about what to say. And how can I say it in love? How can I say it in a way that's not offensive? And sometimes that takes a lot of praying. The only time you should pray about whether or not you should say something is if you're trying to decide whether or not you want to be offended. But if you are offended, then you have no choice, scripturally, but to go to that person, relate honestly with them, and say it in love. in hopes that you will reconnect the situation and connect sincerely. All right, off the soapbox. All right, next one. And then, which leads us, after someone relates honestly with you, then what? Forgive quickly, because you might be offended. It's like, I start off, I'm offended that somebody said something or slighted me in some way, abused me in some horrible fashion, and I get offended. But I'm going to do what the Bible said. I'm going to go to you, and I hate it when you do that. I'm going to relate honestly and say, it hurt my feelings when you did that. And then you go, well, how dare you get offended? I didn't mean anything. Gosh, what's your problem? Ah, then the offense can go to the next person, which is why you didn't want to relate honestly in the first place, didn't it? I knew this would happen. I knew it. Pastor's all like, oh, connect. Oh, be sincere. Oh, tell the truth in love. Oh, sure. And then I did it. And guess what happened? It all blew up in my face. Why? Because everybody needs to do what the Scripture says. If we're going to grow together, if we're going to be healed, we need thing with and for each other, and then when we do the right thing with and for each other, then the other needs to not be offended that someone came to the truth, that came and told you the truth in love. If someone tells you the truth in love and relates honestly with you, say thank you. Say it with me. Thank you. Thank you for your honesty. I think you're totally wrong. You're totally screwed up relating honestly back. But thank you for telling me what the offense was, because now I know how to guard from that in the future. And so we need to forgive quickly when we are offended. Necessary after relating honestly. Matthew 6:14 says, "For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses." Now, at face value, just let it speak for itself. Let that verse speak for itself. I don't even have to go theological on you to try to explain what it means to the people who are like, once saved, always saved, or you can lose it any minute. Hey, I don't even have to go there to try to explain this. Just let the verse speak for itself. Forgive, so that your heavenly Father will forgive you. Just leave that alone for a second. But what I do see there is, don't use time like a tool of punishment. Forgive quickly means that you don't get the luxury of holding on to it and being mad about it for a while. Because if you get mad at somebody and you're like, okay, I'm going to relate honestly, and I'm going to connect sincerely, and I'm going to tell the truth in love, but I'm not ready yet. Well, to some degree, I understand that, because your emotions need to have time to calm down and get under the control of the Spirit. You need time to be able to do what? Pray. Lord, fill me with your Spirit. That's all the time you need. Anything beyond the 5 seconds it takes to say, Lord, fill me with your Spirit, then you are wasting God's time, your time, and letting a hurt go on that should not. We need to forgive quickly. Are you going to end up forgiving anyway? Duh! According to that, we got no choice, right? We have to forgive anyway. So why don't we forgive quickly? Because we want to get our pound of flesh, don't we? God may forgive you, but I haven't. I'm better than God, see? God may forgive quickly, but I haven't forgotten. And I know that I have to forgive or God won't forgive me. And so I'm just going to drag it out as long as I can. And I'm not going to connect sincerely. I'm not going to relate honestly. I'm not going to forgive quickly. I'm just going to make an opportunity for the devil to come in and just tear up more and more and more and more. Yeah, no growth, no worship, no passion in prayer, no passion in worship. Wondering why you're not blessed. Wondering why you're depressed. Maybe we can eat some more ice cream. We'll feel better. Forgive someone. It's better than ice cream. I know it's hard to believe. Forgive. Don't use time like a tool of punishment. If you're going to forgive, then forgive quickly. If you're not going to forgive, just tell God, sorry God, I can't forgive. And deal with that issue honestly with God while He helps you, reminds you of this verse. But if you're going to forgive anyway, then forgive now. Don't wait till the end of this message. Forgive now. Forgive quickly. All right. Core value. Serve tangibly. Serve tangibly. In Mark 9:35, it says, He sat down and called the 12 and said to them, If anyone desires to be first, he shall be last of all and servant of all. We're talking about how to save the planet now. How to relate with one another. How to relate outside ourselves. He sat down and called the 12. If anyone desires to be first, he shall be the last of all. The what? Servant of all. Right. So we need to serve. And of course, the next verse says in Matthew 20:28, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give His life a ransom for many. So if we're going to be like Jesus, then we have to learn how to serve. If we want to draw closer to Him, if we want to love the Lord with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, if we want to love our neighbors, ourselves, if we want to obey God in that, then we need to learn how to do what He did, and that was it is to serve. So we've got to learn to serve, and we've got to learn to serve in a way that is for eternity. Now, the question comes, where or how are you serving now? Just think about it in your own mind. Where or how are you serving others now? See, because love gives. And as you're thinking about what or where are you serving in God's kingdom now, and it doesn't have to be here, it can be somewhere outside of this place, or it can be in this place, or out wherever. But as you're thinking about how or whether or not you're serving now, ask yourself, does what you're doing matter for eternity? If what you're doing does not matter for eternity, then you're probably not serving anyone. Does playing video games count for eternity? No. Not unless you're using that to talk through the headset and lead somebody to Jesus as you're blowing them away with the guns and stuff, you know. It doesn't mean you can't play video games. Young people, I'm not trying to be too hard on you. I got an addict at my house already. I'm trying to deal with that addiction right now. But does what you're doing matter for eternity? Are you serving people in a way that is doing what the hands and feet of Jesus would do if He were here? And if so, then you are doing something that matters for eternity. If you are serving your fellow man in a way that is what Jesus would do, then you're doing something that matters for eternity. If in the regular course of your business, you act in a way that is what Jesus would do, then what you're doing matters for eternity. I won't go into the details of it, but I learned this whenever I was an insurance claims adjuster and I was doing the right thing, which sometimes hurt people that I would like to have helped. But I learned that in the long run, doing the right thing is doing what Jesus would do. And it matters ultimately in eternity. We need good lawyers. We need good insurance claims adjusters. We need people who are honest at cash registers. We need good policemen. We need people to be honest and do their job the right way and serve tangibly in whatever they're doing in a manner that is like what Christ would do if He was doing it. So I'm not just talking about volunteer work here, although I'm asking you also, are you volunteering at anything? Are you doing anything that helps the kingdom of God? But at the very least, we should be doing our daily lives things and ways in which, what would Jesus do if He were there? We need to serve in real, measurable, tangible ways that matter for eternity. If you're praying with someone, you're talking to someone, maybe that can't really be too tangible. Maybe you can't really touch, but you can say, you can think in your mind, yeah, I prayed with some people. Yeah, I listened. Yeah, I was there for someone. You know, I stood in the gap for somebody. You know, somebody was telling me the other day that, you know, just tell me, Will wasn't worth a can of rotten tomatoes. And, you know, I said, yeah, he is, too. You're worth a can of rotten tomatoes. Just one. That's looking out for somebody. Now, not very well. But no matter what we do, we need to do it in a way that is tangible, something that is counting for eternity, something that shows care for one another. I'm going to move on from serve tangibly. And then instruct carefully. Now you might think, well, gosh, I don't teach, so, you know, this doesn't apply to me. But listen to it. Matthew 28:20 says, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. This is part of the Great Commission, where he said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, teaching them, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And you might say, well, I don't... in children's ministry teaching. I'm not teaching a small group, one of our life groups. This doesn't really apply to me. But you see, yeah, we teach by example. And by the way, what did Jesus say? He said, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. Do you know how often and how tempting it is for us as church folk to teach not the things that Jesus actually said to do, but little helper things along the way. In the early 1970s, the hippies were all with long hair, and they didn't take baths, and they all took drugs, and listened to something evil called rock and roll, and, you know, and then the church was like, ah, hippies! You know? And so, when the hippies started getting saved in the Jesus movements, and the hippies started coming into church, churches started complaining and saying that they're wearing out the carpet. They smell. Look at their long hair. When are they going to shave, hippie? And so many of the hippies were turned away and were disgusted and walked away from that. But that isn't what Jesus taught to do. He didn't say, if anyone will follow me, he will shave his face and cut his hair. He said, if you want to follow me, if you want to show me that you love me, you'll keep my commandments. What kind of commandments? I don't know. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And love your neighbor as yourself. That means you set up a rock and roll band singing praises to Jesus and hand out bread and soup to people or something. Can you do that as a hippie? Yeah. And so as a reaction to that lifestyle, along comes me, late in that generation. The hippies I was like 5 years old when the hippie movement was like going strong. Well, by the time I went to Bible college, the church had already figured out how to handle this hippie thing. We'll catch our young people early. We'll nip this thing in the bud. We'll start telling them if they'll just cut their hair off where it doesn't touch their ears, it'll never reach their back. And since hippies out there have drugs, sex, and rock and roll and clearly aren't following Jesus, well, then you need to cut your hair so that you will not appear to be like the world. And so in cutting of your hair and not going to movies and not, I don't know, what were all the rules? Don't drink Diet Coke. Wear a suit to church. Don't play cards. In the old days, it was don't even drink Coke out of a can because it looked like a beer can, you know. Then all these little rules were added to help people be spiritual. If your dress is an inch above your knee instead of below your knee, then clearly you're not spiritual. If your hair is touching your ears instead of a quarter inch above it, clearly you're not spiritual. If your favorite music has a rock beat to it, clearly you're not spiritual. So I learned how to be spiritual. We didn't go to movies when I was a kid, which really bothered me because Star Trek, the first movie came out. It really bothered me. 1979, December. I remember it still. Hurts me to this day. Never saw it at the theater. Had to watch it on TV when it came out. Forgive quickly. Thank you. It was a sin to go to the movies. Then I went to a Bible college, and they taught us we had hair check every time we'd go out on chapel. Didn't have enough money for a haircut. That didn't matter. Hair couldn't touch your ears. You were not spiritual if your hair touched your ears. Had a friend of mine who failed hair check, got disgusted about it, went down to the local barber, Shaky Jake, the only guy we could afford. He's about 100 years old, his hand shook like this whenever he cut your hair. And he said, Shaky Jake, take it all off. Shave it. And then he went home with a razor and shaved his head all the way bare. and then went to the hair check the next time. Do you know what they did? Instead of applauding him for his hyper-spirituality, they thought he was a rebel. He was a rebel. You know what he rebelled against? Stupidity. He rebelled against the notion that how you dress or how you wear your hair has anything to do with your spirituality. And so Jesus says, teaching them to observe all the things that I have commanded you. All the things that I have commanded you. Not what the church necessarily thinks is spiritual or not. Now we go to a great church, so we don't have to worry about that around here, do we? We would never judge someone else by the outward appearance, would we? We try not to, at least. We try to be a church that teaches what Jesus said about these things. Oh, by the way, Ralph, you cut your ponytail off, didn't you, brother? Buddy, let me shake your hand. This is a spiritual man right here. His hair is a foot and a half long just a few weeks ago, and he cut it off. Oh, praise Jesus, another disciple. Took him 40 years, but he finally did it. You know what I'm talking about, don't you? You lived this movie, didn't you? Instruct carefully. Not your religious traditions, but what legacy are you passing out to other people? Everybody instructs somebody. Everybody has an influence on somebody. So instruct carefully with a good example. And then managing wisely is the Matthew 25:21 says, His Lord said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord. The Lord wants us to be faithful over things on earth so that we can have blessings in heaven. But God wants us to learn how to be good managers of our money on earth. Why? Because when you're broke, you can't help anybody else. When you're broke, you can't give to the building fund. When you're broke, you'd say, buddy, I'd give you the shirt off my back if I just had an extra one. You know? My dad used to get so disgusted at people say, brother, I'd give the shirt off my back if I could just help you. Well, but you can't because you don't got nothing. Well, we've all been there when we ain't got nothing. But sometimes we ain't got nothing because we spent it all on stupid stuff. We smoked it all. We drank it all. We gambled it all. We ate it all. We put it all on credit. Now it's haunting us. We're giving it all to the creditors. We need to learn how not to do that. We need to manage wisely. Well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things like money on earth. I will make you ruler over many things in heaven. Enter into the joy of the Lord. So we need to manage wisely our time, our talents, the things that we know how to do, and our treasure. Luke 16:10-12 says, He who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much. And he who is unjust in what is least is unjust also in what is much. Do you want to know if you're trustworthy enough for God to be able to trust you with big things in heaven? Do you steal anything from the office? Do you steal pens? Steal paper clips? Now, if you just accidentally walk out with it, that's one thing. But if you're like, they ain't going to miss that. That's stealing. If you're unfaithful in little things that really don't matter, that won't get you in a lot of trouble, then you cannot be trusted with big things. But if you are faithful in the smallest things, and you do not steal from your employer, and you don't steal from the government, if you got a loophole, use it, man, use it. But if you're lying on your income tax, you cannot be held accountable. You cannot be trusted with the big things. Trust that God is going to give you enough, even though you pay your taxes honestly. Don't steal. He who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much. And he who is unjust in what is least is unjust also in what is much. Therefore, if you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, which is money, who will commit to you the true riches? And if you have not been faithful in what is another man's, who will give you what is your own? Ah, now it hits the rubber, it's the road. I want to own stuff. I want to have stuff. If you want a boat, next time you're on somebody else's boat, take your shoes off or clean up the garbage or offer to help wash the engine out whenever you're done. If you want your own car, don't abuse somebody else's. You ever see punks that are just sliced tires? You know why they slice tires? Because they never owned a car. They never had to buy a tire. You see, if you're faithful in another man's stuff, if you're not faithful in another man's stuff, who will give you what is your own? If you want God to bless you more, then you need to say, God, where in my life do I need to be more faithful with another man's stuff? How can I take care of my employer's equipment better? Do I really need to check the oil on that? He's got plenty of money. He can fix it. If you're faithful with another man's stuff, then God will bless you with your own. What has been entrusted to you is not yours. Manage wisely in order to be able to continue in blessing. This last week was Black Monday. Anybody know what Black Monday is? It's when the NFL coaches get fired. They look at the end of the season and say, you got to go. Why? Because the coach is in charge of that team until he doesn't win, and then he finds out that he isn't really in control of that team at all. He doesn't own that team at all. You got to be faithful in the little things. You have to produce, especially. That's why NFL means not for long. if you don't do well. God wants us to be faithful in the small things so He can bless us in the great things. So for a better way to do life, we need to love God. We need to love others. We need to save the planet. It's just that easy. In there is worship passionately, live fearlessly, pray effectively, gradually, connect sincerely, relate honestly, forgive quickly, instruct carefully, serve tangibly, and manage wisely. And you're like, how am I going to remember all that stuff? Oh, that's right. You got a paper you're taking home, aren't you? That's right. And you're going to hang it on your mirror or your something. Learn these things. Live these things. Ask God to help you with that. Let's stand. We've got to go.